It's always saying that. Okay, well, thank you very much to all that is here attending. Thank you very much, Veronica, to come today for this seminar. It is a great pleasure to have an expertise like you. Annie is from Spain as well. And to be honest, I am very interested in what you are going to say about quantum communication, because you are the perfect one to tell that. So thank you very much for coming. Please, that's all yours. And all you need, just tell me. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Alberto. First of all, can you see my screen well, or do you see this little...
No, I can see it perfectly.
Okay, great. Okay, so I'm going to talk about quantum communications from the fundamental principles to its application. And I will give also an overview of the state of the art in the world, what our countries are doing in the field, and what are the future prospects. So first of all, why do we need quantum communications? What is actually quantum communications? Well, obviously it's a communication that uses quantum principles. And usually these quantum principles are used for encryption, for ensuring the secrecy of the communications. And this is usually more known as quantum cryptography. Now, just in case you don't know what it is, cryptography is the art of preparing a communication with a hidden message that is only intelligible, accessible, or understandable by the person that possesses the key. Now, we can put a very easy example, that is the Julius Caesar cipher. And it's a very basic cipher, which transforms or substitutes every letter of a plain alphabet into the letter of a cipher alphabet. Now, so that in this case, obviously the plain text becomes V, which is this, it gets substituted by Y, and so on. So what is the special characteristics of this is the number of positions that you're going to shift the cipher alphabet over the plain alphabet. And this is what is usually the key. Now, this information must be securely transmitted from to the transmitter and receiver, okay, of the communications, obviously. This, of course, is a very simple form of cipher and can be easily cracked, but it's just for the purpose of illustration. It's in the code book, which is a very very nice book that gives a history of cryptography, which I highly recommend. So what's the problem with current crypto, with the way we protect our information? Well, the problem is the field of quantum computing is evolving quite strongly in the last few years, and is threatening the way we encrypt information nowadays. I don't know if you're familiar with, I guess with your master, you're familiar somehow with quantum computing more than quantum communication, but still I'm going to give a brief introduction. I'm sorry if it's too basic for you, but I give this to put the perspective, the motivation for quantum communications. So in 2019, Google demonstrated what was called quantum supremacy, which is a rather presumptuous way to say that demonstration that quantum calculation performed with quantum processors can be done faster than with a classical computer. Now, this was done by the Sycamore 53-qubit processor, and it demonstrated to perform a calculation much faster than a classical computer. Well, at the beginning, they claimed that this calculation was done in 300 seconds compared to 10,000 years with a classical computer. And then there was some controversy with IBM that they claimed that this was actually, it could be done in Summit, was a super computer, the fastest supercomputer on Earth. And it could be done in 2.5. days instead of 10,000 years, but still the exponential from 200 or 300 seconds compared to 2.5 days is enormous. So they still managed to prove the quantum supremacy, which was a long-term wish of many people working in quantum computing. 1 year later, in 2020, the Chinese group by Jiang Wei Pan in Shanghai, they also managed to prove quantum supremacy. They claim that their computer, which is based on a different technology, a 76-qubit processor, was faster than the Google processor by 10 billion times. So it's the second computer that has achieved quantum supremacy. Now, these operations that they are performing on quantum computers, they're not still are not threatening by any means quantum the security of information right now. But still, it's important because they have proof that they can do certain calculations faster than classical computers. So how is information protected today? So how does encryption work? There are two types of cryptography. One is called symmetric or secret key cryptography. And this cryptography uses only one key for encryption that must be kept in secret. Now, how does it work? It's very simple. The key, who has to be previously transmitted to both parties, is used to encrypt the plain text, which then becomes encrypted, and is decrypted by the same key, which then the receiver recovers the plain text. Now, of course, to achieve this, the key must be previously transmitted. So the way to this type of algorithm is exemplified by the advanced encryption standard, which was standard since 2002 by NIST after an open call where many different algorithms were evaluated. And it's used for classified information by NSA, for example, many other applications by NATO also, etc. Is AES secure? Well, it depends on the key. Obviously, the longer keys are more secure. The algorithm is more secure with longer keys than with shorter keys. But it's assumed to be very secure for 192 and 256 bits. These algorithms are very fast, so that they are used to encrypt high volumes of data, like databases, network communications, hard drives, audio and video, etc. Now, the problem is, how do we send the secret key? This problem was referred in the beginning of the 20th century as a problem of key distribution. And it took many years to solve it by mathematicians and cryptographers. And it wasn't solved until 1976 by Diffie and Hellman, and they developed the famous Diffie-Hellman algorithm, which is used currently in many applications for distribution of keys. And it uses mathematical functions, unidirectional functions, which are easy to go in one way, but hard to reverse. We'll go explain a little bit more about that later. And this sort of cryptography is called asymmetric or public key cryptography. And 1 year later, in 1977, Rivers, Samir, and Adelman, they developed this the RSA algorithm, which is based on same type or the same principle of unidirectional mathematical functions, but on different, slightly different functions. And this is very similar to the Diffie-Hellman algorithm, but it also authenticates transmitter and receiver information. So this sort of cryptography uses two keys, a public and a private key. The public key is known by everyone, and the private key is only known by one person. The way it works is that the plaintext is encrypted using the public key of the receiver, and you get the ciphertext. The receiver can then recover the plaintext using his private key, which decrypts the ciphertext. So this can be easily visualized by a padlock in which everybody has a public key, a padlock that is available to everyone, and everybody can close this information inside, but only the person that has the key, the private key, can open it and access to this information. Now, the lengths of this sort of cryptography are longer than in the case of symmetric cryptography. The minimum length is 1024 bits, but they are computationally more slower, let's say. So they are more directed to encrypt small amounts of data. But this is perfect for secret keys, because in general, there are small amounts of data. So this is a sort of cryptography that's used to encrypt secret keys in general. So we have the secret key, we encrypt it with the public key, and then we accesses the receiver accesses using his private key. So what's the strength of this sort of cryptography? It's based on the factorization problem. The factorization problem, as you might remember from school when we were kids, it was to find the prime numbers that multiply a number, a given number. So in this case, it's obviously 3 times 5. But if the number becomes a little bit bigger, it gets more difficult to crack the number, to find the prime numbers. So if I tell you this number, 391, you will have to trial and error by many different, through quite a long time, until you find the prime numbers, which are 17 times 23. Now, the RSA challenges are open to everybody, to the people that are trying to crack these keys that are available that are available to everybody. So these are the length keys that have been cracked already. The last one in 2009, the 768 bit from RSA, and it took 6 months in ATPCs working in parallel. So you can see that as computing capacity advances, then these keys become insecure. So right now, RSA is considered to be secure if the key length is at least 2048 bits. It's considered to be the safest from that key length, and ideally 496 bits. So how long does it take to do mathematical operations? Well, when you add two numbers of n bits, an addition, it takes a linear time with the number or with the length of the numbers. When you multiply two numbers of n bits, the time it takes is quadratic, so it's of the order of n squared. However, when you factorize a number of n bits, the time you take to do it is it has an order of e to the power of n. So this graphically, visually, you can see that this is the time it takes for an exponential, and this is the time it takes for polynomial and a linear time. So this, it can be visualized by the famous tale of the farmer that the king wanted to reward him by inventing chess. And the farmer asked him to give him a number of grains, which followed a mathematical rule, which was to multiply by 2 each square of the chessboard. And so the king said, okay, no problem. It seemed like this number would be acceptable. However, if you multiply this by 64, you have a number like that at the end, the grains in total. So this has the exponential effect is sometimes underestimated. And this is what the factorization problem, when n is sufficiently large, the effect of this time is much longer than the rest of polynomial or linear times, obviously. Problem with this is that factorizing is not proven mathematically that it's difficult to solve. Now, what happens if a quantum computer tries to factorize? So this is what Peter Shor proposed in the 90s, and he proposed a quantum circuit to solve factorization. And he proved that the time it took for a quantum computer to do the factoring, it was polynomial, dependent on polynomial time with the number of bits of this number. So the time to crack this passed from exponential to polynomial. And this is very bad news for public key cryptography or asymmetric cryptography. So effectively breaks at the public key cryptography. But at this time, that was the 90s, nobody had really thought that a quantum computer could ever be built. The recent progress with the big giants like Google, Intel, IBM, etc., working in exponentially higher number of qubits by each year, this is becoming a little bit more worrying for information security. Also, we have to look at Grover's algorithm, which was another quantum algorithm. And this time, this is directed to all the type of cryptography. this algorithm proposes to do something in this searching a database that proved to pass from a classical time, from a linear time, to a square root. So a quantum computer would do this task in a square root of the number of entries, this the x-axis being the number of entries. So this is much less time to do this this operation, which is just looking in an assorted database. So imagine that this unsorted, so no order telephone guide. Imagine that you have an unordered telephone guide and you have to look for a particular entry, and it has 1 million entries, 1 million names. So this would take 11 days with classical algorithms, and only 15 minutes with Grover's algorithm with quantum gates. So this is quite significant, and the impact in cryptography is specifically in the brute force attack that you can do to symmetric systems, symmetric crypto systems like ICE that we explained before. Now, of course, the threat in symmetric cryptography was previously thought there was enough to just double the key. Okay, you double the key and you restore your previous security because the key length would double. The problem with this is that there are also other threats on symmetric cryptography that I'm not going to go into detail in, but you can look at them if you're interested with the Simons algorithm. It's a work by Naya Plasencia's group, a Spanish researcher. And they have proven that many modes of operation with symmetric cryptography are threatened dramatically by this algorithm. So it's not only Grover's algorithm now, but also Simon's algorithm. So also symmetric cryptography is not completely guaranteed. Security is not completely guaranteed. So this is the end of classical cryptography. What do we do now? Well, of course, we can always go to the rescue of the Bernard cipher. The Bernard cipher is called the perfect secret, and it works very simply. You have a plain text and you combine it with a key and you just do a binary addition, two binary addition, and you get the ciphertext. Now, this is you can express it by the encryption, which is the message short the key. And it's mathematically 100% secure if you accomplish the following. It is used only once, the key is used only once. It's 100% random, and it's as long as the message. So the problem translating how we generate random and completely secure keys. Well, this is actually achieved by quantum key distribution. So quantum mechanics poses the problem and the solution at the same time, which is quite ironic. So what does quantum key distribution do? It detects the presence of an eavesdropper in the channel, leaving a fingerprint on it. So it basically is a fingerprint that is unavoidable once someone measures these quantum states. And the very good thing about it is that the security that we can achieve with it is information theoretic. This means that it's independent on any advance on computer capacity that it may happen, even if this is a quantum computer. So because the security is not based on computational assumptions, it's based on information theory. In particular, in the laws of quantum mechanics, and as you, I'm sure you recall, at some point having studied the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which states that there are pairs of variables like position and velocity of a particle that cannot be measured deterministically and ambiguously without introducing an error. And this was actually very, very well explained by Stephen Hawking in A Brief History of Time, which stated that to find the position and velocity of an electron, of course, you have to shine some light into it. But the smallest amount of light you can shine into it is a quanta of light. And still this has a wavelength. Now, if you shine energy to a wavelength with an energy to an electron, you're going to move the position, and then you are going to perturb it. So that's what Heisenberg principle states, that it's impossible to measure both the position, which is the reflected light here, and the velocity without perturbing them. The funny thing is that the more you measure, the more accurate you measure one of them, the more inaccurate you measure the other variable. In this case, if you want to measure the position with high accuracy, what you will do is to increase the wavelength. So this, because this is the error you make when you measure the position. The error is the distance between the peaks or the troughs. Now, if you want to decrease this error and measure the position more accurately, you're going to increase the wavelength. Increase the frequency, sorry. So you decrease the wavelength. But when you do that, the light becomes more energetic. So you perturb the electron farther away, his speed. So this is the relation between them. So they're usually called non-orthogonal variables. Also, we have to take into account the no-cloning theorem, which is means that copies are not permitted in a quantum world. So you cannot make a copy of an unknown quantum state, because actually, if you could do that, you will violate Heisenberg uncertainty principle, because you could measure the position and velocity in both of them deterministically without making any error. So this is very important, because it avoids an eavesdropper of the key. It makes a copy and find the information of the state. Now, many uncertainty principle holds between many pairs of variables, not only position and velocity, which are stated here. And in particular, we're going to look at the non-orthogonal polarization states. Now, the polarization is the way of vibration, the way the electric field vibrates. So you can vibrate in all directions, left-handed, circular, right-handed, linearly in any direction, or it can be just unpolarized. So now, the first protocol of quantum key distribution was proposed in 1984 by Bennett and Russell, working in IBM. And it follows, I'm going to explain it right here. So Alice wants to send a sequence to Bob. This is the sequence that Alice wants to send. And to encrypt the information, she's going to use two polarization bases. So in this polarization, the rectilinear polarization and circular polarization. So independently of each bit, she's going to select one of these two bases randomly. Now, for the rectilinear basis, she's going to use two states, vertical and horizontal, each of them encrypting the zero and the one. And for the circular basis, she's going to use right circular for the zero and left circular for the one. So now she has to be consistent with the bit and the basis she used to encrypt the information. So in this case, she has to use the vertical. For the one, she has to use the horizontal, and so on. Okay, so she has streams of photons, and she's going to send this to Bob. So she sends these photons through a channel, and not all photons that Alice sent are received by Bob. Obviously, there are some loss, because there's an absorption always in any transmission channel. But there's no problem about that. And now Bob has to measure these states, because he doesn't know in which polarization each photon is coming, but he knows what type of polarization the photons are. So because this is public in the protocol, so he knows he has to use rectilinear circular detection bases. Now, what are these in practice? A rectilinear basis is just a polarizing beam splitter or Wollaston prism. This is a prism that always reflects the vertical component and transmits the horizontal component. It's as simple as that. So having this into account, let's say that Bob receives with rectilinear basis, it's just this prism, and Alice is sending a vertical state. Now, in this case, this vertical state is always going to be reflected. So Bob puts his detector there, the detector zero, and receives it with 100% probability. Now, if he's going to receive a zero, and this is always transmitted. And WOP detects one with 100% probability. So in this case, it's all good. But what happens if he is using these bases and Alice is sending circular states? Now, circular state is the electric field rotating, so the probability of receiving in 0 or 1 for both states is 50%. It's absolutely random. So in this case, when Alice is in a circular state and Bob is using rectilinear bases, the result is completely random. This is because these two variables are not compatible. Now, let's say now Bob is going to use a circular base. And this the circular base is just adding a wavelength retarder, a half quarter wavelength that always converts the right circular into vertical and the left circular into horizontal. So in this case, every time that he measures these states, he's going to receive them deterministically again. And the last possibility is that using the circular bases, photons coming into the rectilinear bases are received. In this case, vertical is converted into circular and horizontal into circular on the opposite direction. And he's going to receive again the photons in a random manner. So there are four types of measurement that Bob can do, and they are two deterministic, but Alice is sending this test and Bob is receiving the compatible base, and same with the circular, and two ambiguous, which happen when they don't use the same basis for meeting and detecting the photons. So Bob uses randomly these bases. And depending on the basis used, he has received the photon correctly or incorrectly. In this case, because he has used the same basis set, he's going to receive the photon correctly. But in this case, for example, you will have 50% chance of repolarizing the photon in the wrong direction. So in this case, he has done it wrong. So in this sequence that Bob has received, there are errors and there are places where there's no, he hasn't received any photon. Now, in this step of the protocol, what they do is they use a public channel. So it's a channel that Eve can be listening to, but has to be authenticated, okay? So Alice and Bob must know that they're talking to each other, but it's public in this channel. So any internet connection would do. Alice and Bob compare the bases through a public channel. And they only keep the photons in which they have used the same bases to encrypt and decrypt the photons. Okay, which are the red instances. The green ones are discarded from the key. They just eliminate those from the keys, okay? And they also will eliminate the photons in which Bob did not receive anything. So this is a final common sequence. Now, remember that Alice and Bob never reveal the value of the bit. They only reveal the bases they use, okay? And I must remind you too that this is to send the encryption key. This is not to send the communication yet. Now, the communication is going to be encrypted with this key, but we're just sending the key. So, can we detect an eavesdropper? Now, we have said that we have a quantum channel and a classical channel. And let's assume that an eavesdropper. She puts herself in the middle and she intercepts the photons from Alice, measures them and resends them to Bob. Can we detect if he intercepts and resends this information? The answer is yes. Why? Because she's going to introduce an unavoidable error detectable by Alice and Bob. How does this work? It's very simple to say mathematically. These are the 8 options of the bases that Alice, Eve and Bob can use, because they are completely random. So these are 2^3. And in which of these cases are going to be part of the key? Only the ones in which Alice and Bob use the same bases. So these are the only 4 that they're going to use for the key. They're going to keep those only. Now, in which of these instances, Eve introduces an error? Here, she doesn't introduce an error because she has used the same basis as Bob. so no error is introduced. But in these two cases, she has used a different basis than Bob. So their probability of error of 1/2, 50%. So the total probability of error is 1/2 times 1/2 + 1/2/4, which are the four possibilities that will be part of the key. So this is an error of 25%, which is quite big and is enough to detect. It's more than enough. Now, so what do we do actually to test this security, this percentage? So what Alice and Bob will do is they publicly reveal a part of the key, just a tiny bit of it, but statistically representative, of course. And they calculate what is called the quantum bit error rate. And this is just the number of incorrect bits, because they are basically comparing their bits. So they know which ones they don't match. And they divide this over the total number of bits, the correct and incorrect ones. So this is as simple as just comparing the sequence and knowing that, well, in some instances, the binary states don't match, and they divide it over the total number of bits. If the quantum bit error rate is below a security threshold that depends really on the protocol, but it goes from 8% to maybe 20%, depending on the attacks that you assume, then if it's below it, they will keep this key as secure and use it for encryption. But if it's above it, above this threshold, then this key must be discarded. It's not considered secure. This is actually automatically done by the software usually that you implement to do these calculations and to distill and reconcile your key. So this is how it works with the security threshold. And then also, how does the QBR is affected? By what factors is affected? It's affected by dark counts in the single photon detectors. We'll go later on explain a little bit more about the devices we're going to use. But basically, these are wrong counts that are produced in the detectors by thermal effects, and they don't correspond really to the detection of an event. So this is going to increase your quantum bit error rate. Also errors in the polarization or the phase, which are all types of protocols, but the ones we've seen with polarization, this is sometimes it's not perfect. You cannot produce ideal linear states. So there will always be components in the opposite polarization that can go through the detectors and detect it as a wrong bit. Also, unwanted light contributions, which can happen from solar or other kind of light sources origin from your surroundings. And of course, the transmission distance, because when the distance is increased, the absorption is increased. So the number of correct bits, which is in the denominator, decreases. So your QBR increases. So that is something that also affects your quantum bit error rate, and of course an eavesdropper. But you need to assume that all your errors, whether they come from an eavesdropper or not, are caused by an eavesdropper. So all your errors are assumed to be originated by an eavesdropper. So I explained you the BB84 protocol, but there's also another protocol, the B92, which only needs two non-orthogonal states to ensure the security. And you can use polarization or phase encoding. I'm going to show you what phase encoding is just in a moment. And we encrypt the zero state with a 90 degree state and the 45 by the one. So Bob, in this case, receives the states by using, this is Bob measuring, and he uses a non-polarizing 50-50 beam splitter. So he just randomly route these photons. And in the case these are transmitted, they are, which are the ones, they are minimized. So ones are blocked, they don't pass through. And in this case, if it goes to this other channel, they are 50% transmitted, okay? And the zero, it gets blocked in the opposite channel. So here it gets blocked. And in the other channel, it passes through by 50%. Okay, so at the end, you can actually correctly distinguish your states at the expense of a loss, which is 75%. It's quite a lot, but it's the price you have to pay to distinguish your states. And also, if an eavesdropper intercepts your photons, she is obliged to cause a performance disturbance too. So in the form of loss. So you will detect this because your QBR will increase. So Alice will send a sequence of random bits such as in the BB84 protocols, and she will encrypt it in these two polarization states. And Bob will randomly select the type of polarizers he's going to put in front of it, he will detect these states. But in the form of loss, he will have to discard many states, but the ones that he has received, he's sure that they are correct. So Alice will tell Bob. Bob will tell Alice in which instances he measured, so Alice can keep the states that Bob has to. So he tells her the times in which he received the states, but not the actual values of the bits. So they finally arrive to a common sequence too. So once you have transmitted the key, you have to use your encryption algorithm. You have to choose what encryption algorithm you're going to use. You can use the Vernon cipher, as we mentioned before, because this is a very secure option, but it's also slower because you need a key that is as long as your message. So it's good for highly sensitive information, but it's not very quick. Now, if you want to send your information with a higher speed, and you have applications where security is not as demanding, but you need more bandwidth, then you can use the advanced encryption standard cipher and the key generated from QKD. So this is an option that is used by many commercial products of QKD. So there's also the possibility of encrypting the information of the key in the phase, okay, of the optical phase of a light beam. And I know maybe this is too much detail, but basically what you're gonna do between Alice and Bob is you use a Mach-Zehnder interferometer, which is the difference between the beams that arrive to the detectors is the difference between them is a pi, is dephased by pi, these two outputs. And this is done by just putting the beam splitter in the right way. And you have phase modulators in Alice and Bob. So what Alice prepares a sequence of ones and zeros, and she selects randomly between pi multiples and pi over two multiples. So she will encrypt the zeros when she uses the pi multiple basis, which will be equivalent to the rectilinear basis in a polarization encoding. Depending on she chooses zero or pi, she will encrypt the zeros or the ones. And when she's using the other basis, the pi two multiples, then the values for the zeros and ones are those that I'm showing you there. Now, Bob, what he does is randomly applying either zero or pi over two. So it's basically the same analogous to Bob in the polarization encoding, choosing between the rectilinear and the circular basis. So at the end, when the difference between the phase that they have used, Alice and Bob, is zero, then all the intensity goes through the detector zero. So Bob receives a zero. And when the difference between the phases applied by Alice and Bob is pi, all the intensity goes to the detector one. You can see this by just doing the calculation here. K times the difference of length is almost zero because this is the balancing of an interferometer. So they are dephased by pi. So they basically, depending on this difference of zero and pi, they will go all to one channel or the other. And when the difference is pi over two, then this means that the intensity is divided in two. So this is basically is equivalent to when they don't use the same basis, okay? What they are going to do is they're going to share the basis they use, whether this is pi multiple or pi over two multiple. That's all the information they're going to use. And with this, they will be able to arrive to a final common sequence because it's all analogous to a polarization encoding scheme. Now, based on these schemes, but more sophisticated the systems are the most widely used commercial system by ID Quantique. And well, they come from the primigenious system was built in 2002. and by the Swiss company Quantic. Now I'm going to mention also how quantum key distribution can be based on entanglement of photons. This property entanglement, highly entangled particles, they have the property in the particular entanglement of that I'm showing you right now, is means that when you measure one of them, the other is maximally entangled in the opposite direction, and vice versa. Okay, when you measure this and it's this state, then you know that the other particle is going to be on the opposite state. And this is actually very, very surprising, because particles collapse without any external perturbance once the other has collapsed. So somehow they sense this, they behave like a single particle, even if they are kilometers away. So the funny thing about this is we can use this for encryption, for key distribution. And if you send these maximally entangled states through two users, Alice and Bob, who are going to use a rectilinear basis, as I showed you before, what happens is that when the state collapses into a horizontal in Alice, Bob's state will collapse to a vertical state. So Bob, all he has to do is that if he knows he has used the same basis as Alice, he knows that what bit Alice has, and he will just flip his bit, and he knows that he has the same bit as Alice. This is very, very interesting. Now, what happens when they use different bases? Now, of course, if this state collapses to the vertical, then the vertical state that should appear here, it will have a probability of aligning with the right diagonal or left diagonal by 50%. So there will be an error if you don't use the same basis, okay? Just as in the polarization encoding BB84 protocol. And the most interesting part is when this state is projected in diagonal basis. So when this happens, if it collapses on the right diagonal, then the other state in Bob will always collapse into the left diagonal. So they are again maximally entangled in opposite ways. So this state behaves the vertical horizontal behaves also like a diagonal diagonal in both ways, let's say. So in this case, Bob only flips the state 2, and he knows he has the same bit as Alice. And this is because they are quantumly entangled. This would not happen with a classical state, because with a classical state, they will have probabilities of this state of projecting in different ways. So when they're both in opposite directions, the visibility that measures this is maximum. And this shows that this is a quantum mechanically state. And if it collapses in the other direction, this other state in Bob will always collapse to the opposite direction again. So again, Alice and Bob will know exactly what bit has the other. So this is summarized in this table that you can find in this master thesis by Chris Ervin, which is very interesting. And you can look at it into more detail, but this is a very interesting protocol, and it's also widely implemented. So this is the BBM 92 protocol, and the BB84 are the most implemented protocols, I would say. So what do we need to implement a QKD system? So as we have seen, we need single photon emission. This is ideally done through single photon sources. Now, how can we do this? Well, you can mix in different materials. You can create kind of defects, which are bubbles, in which each of them, there's an electron trapped inside. So what you can do is that if you insert this layer of quantum dots, they're called quantum dots, you insert it in a resonant cavity of a micropillar. And this is what our collaborators many years ago did to produce single photon sources that we characterized in the UK when I was actually doing my PhD thesis. And the problem with this is that in the integration of these single photon sources into the real optical systems is difficult. I forgot to say that once you have this and you shine light in pulses with a laser, they will only produce one photon at a time. So this is a single photon source. But as I said, integration is not always easy. Sometimes it's just easier for us when we work with these systems to just attenuate laser diode emission to achieve single photons. So single photons follow a Poisson statistics though, and this has implications on the number of multiphotons. So this means that you use a mean photon number of 0.1, less than 0.5 pulses will contain more than one photon, which is what you want to minimize. Of course, you need to decrease this portion of photons or pulses that have more than one photon to not give information to the eavesdropper. But to do this, you really need to put your power down. So you have to decrease your power by one order of magnitude of your frequency when you use a 0.1 photons per pulse. And this is a good thing. Not many photons carry more than one photon, not many pulses, sorry. But 90% of these pulses are empty. Now, how do you generate single photon pairs? Well, these are generated by parametric down conversion, which is basically using a laser beam, shine a laser beam over a non-linear crystal, and you would generate two cones of light, a vertical and a in this cone, in the upper cone, you would generate vertically polarized photons. And in the horizontal polarized will be generated in the other cone. But in the intersection of these two cones is where you get your entangled photons. There, photons are polarized in both directions simultaneously, okay? This is quite funny, but it's the way that the light works. Okay, so I'm just gonna stop for a minute here while I switch off my mobile, because it's all the time giving me push notifications and it's driving me crazy. Just give me a minute.
Not a problem, Veronica.
Okay.
It's absolutely fine.
Okay.
Yes, well, I would like to say one thing that one of you has already do it, but in case you have any questions, you can put in the chat, and at the end of the presentation, we will ask Veronica, of course. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Sorry for that. I'm going to go on. So how do we detect single photons? So this is done through avalanche photodiodes mainly, and one of the technologies used. And this is just a pin diode, a photodetector, in which a multiplication zone is inserted. So this multiplication zone is to obtain a gain, is to multiply the effect of the absorption of a photon. And this is based on this avalanche is based on impact ionization, and this means that an electron hole pair that is formed from the absorption of a photon has enough kinetic energy to impact ionize many other electron hole pairs until an avalanche sufficiently self-sustaining is produced. Okay, and this happens because the electric field is sufficiently large. So in this regime, the APD or avalanche photodiode is transformed into a single photon avalanche diode. So you can see the where this happens is called the breakdown voltage. So above this voltage, the avalanche photodiode behaves as a single photon avalanche detector. And of course, once an avalanche takes place, you need to use some quenching electronics to bring down the voltage below the breakdown voltage to put the device ready for the next detection of the photon. Also, you can use superconducting detectors to detect single photons. So what you have is the superconducting effect, and which of course is means that the resistance is zero. But what happens is that when a photon is absorbed, it impacts this superconducting material, a hotspot is formed, and by diffusion starts to grow, and it suppresses the superconducting effect. So that means that there's going to be a resistance that you can measure. You measure the resistance, and you can detect the photon that way. So these are the three technologies. The avalanche photodiodes are these ones, the 15 in the INGAS SPAT here, that is capable of detecting 50-50 nanometers. And they have detection efficiencies quite low compared to silicon avalanche photodiodes. And they're commercial, they're about 3,000 each. The silicon ones, and the INGAS pads are much expensive. I think they are about 20,000 each. And this is the superconducting detectors, and each of these is about 17,000. But you need to buy also a cryostat with liquid helium. Well, it's actually a small cryostat with a closed circuit, but still the whole package of four detectors is about 100,000, more above 100,000 euros. So they're quite expensive. But on the other hand, if they can detect both wavelengths for the spectrum of silicon and the spectrum of INGAS. So this is quite good in that sense. Now also, it's very important the random number generation, because the primigenius, or the sequence, the seed sequence of Alice is going to be at the end generate the key. This sequence must be truly random. It turns out that only quantum phenomena are only random, because classical phenomena at the end is behind a classical process that you can eventually simulate. So you need to use quantum processes to generate quantum random numbers. It's truly random generator numbers. And for example, ID Quantique company, they use the transmission or reflection of photons over a semi-transparent mirror, which is a 50% chance. So that's the way they generate random numbers. Now, we talked about the consequence of no cloning, and this actually means that amplifying quantum signals is not straightforward, it's not simple. You can do it, but not directly amplifying the signal, as a classical system will do, but taking advantage of what is called quantum teleportation. So this is a process that allows to swap the entanglement between pairs of variables. Okay, this is the entanglement swapping effect. Basically, what you would do is that you have entangled particles here, and you perform certain states, certain measurements in a way that at the end you will have this entanglement shared by the these two particles that travel here and here. So this would be what is called a quantum repeater. And it will share, if you put enough intermediate points, quantum repeaters, in between your communications, at the end you will share the entanglement between particles, and ideally to any distance. So this is very complex to do in practice. There are many groups trying to do this, and progress is being done, but we still don't have these quantum repeaters commercial available. We have talked about QKD using single photons and using single photon detectors. But there's all other way to do quantum key distribution, which is based on what is called continuous variables. So the previous system that we talked about, as I said, we use single photons for the quantum signal, we use individual photons, and for detection, we use single photon detectors. Now, for continuous variables, for generation of states, we use what is called coherent states. So a coherent state is a quantum version of a classical electromagnetic field. So basically what happens if you're going to represent an electromagnetic field on the phase space, which is just representing the real and the imaginary part of the fields, you actually have a circle of uncertainty in this point. You don't have a point. There's actually a circle by quantum mechanics. This is something that derives also from the position and velocity uncertainty, because this plane is proportional to the plane of the position and velocity of a particle. It comes from that. It means that there's an uncertainty in this phase and amplitude, which is represented on the quadrature phase space. And if you reduce the amplitude of your state, this uncertainty becomes even more apparent. So playing with this and reducing the amplitude of the states using coherent states, which are very close to zero, you can exploit this uncertainty for quantum communications in an analogous way as we did with the polarization basis sets. And the good thing about these systems is that you can detect them using classical telecommunication technology, which is homodyne detection. This is a way to detect which basically subtracts the intensity of two fields and is dependent on the phase. So in this type of system, we're going to encrypt on the phase space, and we're going to detect with homodyne detection, which are cheaper, much cheaper than a single photon detector. These detectors are about 3,000 euros. Also, they have some advantages to in free space systems that we will see later on. Now, the transmission channel of QKD systems can be optical fiber, okay, such as in the telecom industry, or and the fiber you have three transmission windows in wavelength, which are 850, 1300, and 1550. Now, you can also transmit through air. And what are the good things about the atmosphere of the air is that it's not dispersive. So this means that you can send optical pulses without getting them to spread in time. They are not birefringent. It's not birefringent, which means that polarization is preserved. And the transmission windows are compatible with the technologies for single photon detectors, which are silicon and InGaAs. The disadvantages are that it's depending on meteorological conditions. For example, in the case of fog, you have quite a high attenuation on infrared and all the visible and infrared spectrum, basically. And you need direct line of sight, obviously, between the transmitter and receiver. And also you have turbulence, atmospheric turbulence. But this can be compensated for. Still, and these are the transmission windows, which are shared. This is transmitted in our urban aerosol conditions. And that means this is basically in a city. And if you go to a rural environment, this will increase, the transmission will go higher, will go much higher than this. But I'm showing the representative case of a city, which is the environment we used to work. And you can see that transmission windows are 850 and 5050, which is the same case as the fiber. Now, what's the problem? The problem is the absorption in fiber limits the distance, obviously. So we have a maximum transmission distance, which is about, in a very ideal case, of 250 kilometers for quantum communications. In practice, it's much less than that. And this means that every distance of this, the maximum distance, you need to put what is called a trusted node. In this trusted node, you recover your key and you encrypt it again. But this trusted node is actually a security vulnerability. You need to make sure that nobody gets in. So you have to have physical security, et cetera, et cetera. So this trusted node is the way to increase your distance, but still is a vulnerable part of your network. In the case of air, of course, the transmission in air is limited by the line of sight, which is limited by the Earth's curvature. So you have a limit in both cases, in fiber and in air. So how can we achieve global secure communications? So we have no option but to use a satellite relay that would take Alice's key that wants to send to Bob. To the satellite will move to where Bob is located and then retransmit this key to Bob. So we need a satellite acting as a relay station. Now, in 2007, they performed the test to test the viability of this atmospheric transmission from a LEO to ground that was equivalent to a horizontal path of 140 kilometers between La Palma and Tenerife. And the experiment was done between the Nordic Optical Telescope from La Palma to the ESA Optical Ground Station in Tenerife. So this was a nature communication that was quite important because it proved the viability to do these quantum communications through space. And this was in 2017, China managed to do this huge breakthrough in the field, which implied the transmission of single photons, the transmission of different protocols, of QKD protocols based on entanglement and BB84, different types of protocols. And this in particular is shown a quantum entanglement protocol between two cities in China at more than 1,000 kilometers. So this was, of course, published in Science. And it basically caused quite a huge impact in the world, because no one was really expecting that China was so advanced in this technology. So it somehow made other actors in the world to react and increase their interest in the field, such as the US or or actually Europe, which was actually where the field was born. But somehow China managed to get ahead in the field and is actually the leader of the field without any doubt. We must say also that the way that wireless networks are evolving, the future looks like QKD is going to be well integrated in these networks, because optical channels are increasingly, laser communication channels are increasingly used, because for many reasons. One of them is that more constellation of satellite constellations are being launched because small satellites are cheaper to fabricate and to launch. CubeSats that are quite small, quite compact, and even microsatellites and nanosatellites, and they use laser communications because they need to transmit very vast volumes of data from Earth observation, from climate, from defense origin, that they need to transmit to Earth. And RF channels, radio frequency classical channels, are already very congested. So we need these laser communications, and many programs in the world are advancing strongly in that, and we'll see this in a moment. And also the Internet of Things will need, sorry, can you see this band that I have here? Probably you can, right? I'm just gonna close it. And also the Internet of Things will involve many light wave UAVs, such as those you can see, drones over there, autonomous cars, etc. That they will need to refresh keys every quite frequently, and this will be done through laser communications that are where QKD can be integrated easier in an easier way than in the case of RF communications. So I'm going to talk about our applications. So we focus on QKD links in metropolitan locations. Why? Because there are interesting use cases, which are securing communication between buildings in metropolitan range, which high demand and sensitive communications. So this can be many different organizations. And the advantages of free space communication with laser communications are the ease of installation. So you can basically go and put your equipment in a few hours, whereas in the case of fiber, you need to do the whole installation underground, you need your permits, etc. So they're quite fast to install. And also they are portable. So basically you can reaccommodate the position and location of your equipment according to the user needs. So, and And this this is not the case in fiber, which, and also there are many situations where you don't have fiber and you need to install your equipment very, very quickly, like in the case of military scenarios also. So this has applications in other scenarios too. And they don't have licenses associated, such as in the case of RF. The drawbacks, as I mentioned before, weather dependency and turbulence. So you need to make sure that you compensate your turbulence, and the weather dependency sometimes is avoided by basically doing many links at the same time. So if you multiply the number of links you have less probability that one of them is affected by bad weather. This is also done in satellite communication. So this is really the way it's avoided, by having many ground stations, for example. So the objectives that we had to accomplish was the design of a fast system for free space transmission that was capable of working in realistic conditions of free space and telecom networks, which means that it has to be fast, high key transmission. It has to operate in daylight conditions and in high turbulence conditions, which are usually what happens in urban scenarios. So we design our sender, ALICE. We use A50 for the quantum signal and 50-50 for the synchronization signal. The synchronization is because we need to send the clock between ALICE and Bob. And we did this using a different wavelength that goes through the same channel as the quantum signal. So this is very important because they are actually both subjected to the same variations of the transmission medium. So it's going to transmit the clock in sync very well with the quantum signal. It works with very high precision. And we operated all the electronics of ALICE is gigahertz. It goes up to gigahertz. Of course, all the electronics has to have a very high precision of a few picoseconds of timing jitters. So this is our ALICE. We use a post-pattern generator with high frequency to generate the first sequence that ALICE has to send. And this pattern generator control the three bexel, the three lasers, two of them for the B92 protocol at the wavelength A50. And the third of them will be the synchronization laser. So I pushed too fast. These three lasers can operate at 4 gigabits per second. They are vertical cavity surface emitting lasers. They can be modulated at very high speeds. They are then coupled into single mode fiber to suppress the emission to basically clean the mode, which is important for security. They were then attenuated by fiber coupled attenuators. And they are launched into collimators here. They are polarized. This is to correct for errors in the polarization. Sorry about the silence. And sorry about that, it doesn't happen very often. And then they are coupled with the beam splitter. So we have the two states of the B92 protocol already coupled. And this is a 1515 signal for synchronization that is coupled also with another pellicle beam, just a wave plate. And then it's launched into some mirrors and is expanded because we need to expand the beam to be able to transmit it to a long distance. So it's about less than 4 centimeters of diameter that was. It's good to get to distances to about a couple of kilometers. This is a receiver, Bob, who has a Smith-Cassegrain telescope, which is an astronomical commercial telescope. It's designed to reduce coma and spherical aberrations. And we used commercial silicon detectors, single photon detectors, and a high precision time interval analyzer. And of course, we have to filter solar radiation. We're going to see it quite more in detail in the next slide here. So we get the two wavelengths, one for the quantum signal and the other for the synchronization signal. And this Dirac filter will separate both of them. Now, the quantum signal, which has the states, is taken through this path, and the synchronization signal 1550 is taken into avalanche photodetector, and then is taken to the clock of a single time interval analyzer. So it's an electronic card with high precision in the temporal detection of the photons and the pulses. Now, we use a bandpass filter that only detects a window close to 850 nanometers. And we use a plate beam splitter that separates both beams equally. And in channel one, we're going to put our polarizer against the zeros. So we block the zeros and we let pass half of the ones, as we said before. And we do the same in the other channel, but into the opposite state. We use micro positioners, etc., optical fiber, and then we use single photon detectors here that are directed into our electronic car. So here we detect the photons and we check the quantum bit error rate. Okay. We use some retarders to compensate for polarization and imperfections. So we check our system with the only building that we had around that we could use from CSIC, the Institute of Agricultural Sciences, and our institute. So here was Alice, and here was Bob. And this is the crossing the CSIC campus. This is the actual headquarters of CSIC. So it's quite funny how it crosses exactly through the middle. And we had the results. We achieved the 300 meters were safety key rates that were four times larger than similar systems. And secure key rates, considering the worst attacks possible, we got 1 megabit per second at night and 700 kilobits per second a day, etc. And this was one of the magnitude of the similar systems. So we were quite satisfied. This was back in 2013, which has been quite a long time, but we managed to accomplish what we wanted, to have a fast free-space system. Also, we need to take into account that this 300 meters really was equivalent to a longer distance of at least between 1 and 2 kilometers. And this was because the coating of the telescope was optimized for the visible. So we lost almost 80% of the photos for due to this. So this taking into account the errors and the atmospheric turbulence, is really equivalent to a longer distance. But of course, the limitation of our system was turbulence and solar noise. And this is because of what I'm going to show you right now. So this is the quantum bit error rate. This is the quantum bit error rate in red, and this in yellow is the solar background. So this is at night between 9:30, but after 6:30 in the morning, this started to increase. Okay, as this increased, the quantum bit error goes high, and the secret key rate goes down. So it's actually quite bad. It goes down to our secret key rate goes really a tenth of what it was in at nine time. And why this happens? This is what the field of view that Bob sees. So this is basically what Bob is receiving, the quantum signal that Bob is receiving. Because we have atmospheric turbulence, the beam is moving around like this. So we need to leave this sufficiently large to accommodate all this turbulence. But if we could actually track the beam somehow actively, and stop it, actively stopping the beam, we could reduce the field of view. So as we reduce the field of view, we will reduce all the solar background here too, and we wouldn't lose any of the quantum signals. So we would increase our signal to noise ratio, and we will be able to have a much stronger signal. So we started working, studying atmospheric turbulence and seeing how we could apply correcting techniques to optical beams. So atmospheric turbulence affect optical beams in different ways. It spreads the beam farther from the natural divergence. And this beam spreading causes enlargement of the beam as it propagates, which is shown here. It's caused by small eddies, or turbulent eddies. This cannot be compensated, but it can be taken into account in the design of your apertures, of Alice's and Bob's apertures. And also other effect is what is called beam wonder. Beam wonder is caused by larger eddies, turbulence eddies, that move around your beam, the whole beam, and makes your the focal point to dance around. It's like a dancing of the spot. And this actually is what we want to compensate. There's other effect that is called scintillation, which causes spatial and intensity fluctuations of the wavefront. So basically, it moves around the actual transfer mode profile of your beam. This is more complicated to correct. We're actually working now with the Institute of Astrophysics of the Canary Islands, because they do this for the big telescopes to actually correct for the image plane of when they are actually imaging galaxies and other planets, etc. So we're going to work in correcting this beam front. But before, back a few years ago when we started, we restricted ourselves to the lower order aberration, which are the effects of beam one, to this second one, to the movement of the whole beam. So we started working on this. I'm going to pass this slide because it's too much detail. And the actual system that you need, the basics of what you need to correct for this effect, is a fast healing mirror and a position sensitive detector, which measures the fluctuation of the beam. And you you connect your position sensitive detector in a pit loop with your fast hearing mirror. So this means that it's going to decrease the error that he sees, being the error, any position that is deviated from the center. So in this loop, if you calibrate it well and you operate it well, your fast hearing mirror will compensate these fluctuations. So when you do this technique in the transmitter, you do what is called active fine pointing. And if you do it in your receiver, you do fine tracking And you actually will need two of them, the both of them working, so that, to compensate well your turbulence. From the transmitter, you actually pre-compensate your turbulence. You need a beacon that goes from the transmitter through from the receiver to the transmitter, etc. So it's a double bidirectional beacon that you actually need. So the actual devices that we use are fast hearing mirrors, as I mentioned, that are quadrant detectors, that are segmented detectors, and the lateral effect. Position sensitive detectors. So these are quadrant detectors and these are lateral effect. The difference between them is that we use a blind region here in the case of the quadrant detectors, and this gives it more sensitivity to detect through the operation that is done to actually calculate the center of the beam center through these calculations. So we worked in techniques for reducing these aberrations by using two loops, which is not usually done. It's usually done one loop with one fast hearing mirror and one position sensitive detector. So we use two loops because it's equivalent to actual fixing the plane into the plane of the optical axis. You can fix it in two positions. So this is more interesting in a receiver, in an optical receiver, because you decrease aberrations and other types of effects that are not good for your system. So we worked in this double loop system and we tested at 300 meters. I'm not gonna go too much into the details, but we reduce the fluctuations by an order of magnitude. So this was quite good for QKD. We are now working in projects with the quantum network of Telefonica and the University Polytechnic of Madrid, that they have a quantum network in Madrid installed in several nodes. And we are going to bridge the distance of critical infrastructures, which can be hospitals, banks, or airports that are not connected to these networks, and they wish to be connected, but they don't have this connection through optical fiber for many reasons. So what we're going to do is to bridge this gap by sending this information, this using a confidential channel through free space, QKD free space. So this is something we want to do. We're also working with INTA, the Institute of National Techniques of Aerospace here in Spain. for interfacing space to ground platforms and inter-satellite connectivity. We have some projects, and also in these projects are participating astrophysics of the Canary Islands and some companies in the sector of defense and aerospace technologies and the quantum random number generators. And we're also working in continuous variables, QKD protocols, as I mentioned before, and this in particular uses reference signal, which is a pilot tone at a different frequency, which is used in BOB to recover the phase and frequency, phase and frequency from Alice signal in the receivers, which is needed to perform the homodyne detection. So we're also working in this because it's, we want to explore these systems in free space because they are less dependent to solar background light, because this is a wavelength phase dependent detection, frequency dependent detection, which means it's not affected so much by all the spectra, but just a single band. So I'm going to give you an overview of the state of the international powers in quantum communications, very brief. So the US was the first one to build a network in 2004 by the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. And it was developed by the company BBN Technologies in Boston. In free space, they were pioneers. The Los Alamos National Laboratory were pioneers in free space QKD. And they developed a quantum network, hub and spoke, which means a star topology network that is operating in Los Alamos National Laboratory and still operative today. And the United States also has signed in 2019, it was signed by the President of the United States, this initiative into act, which means it's a law with an investment of more than $1 billion for the next 5 years. So there's investing quite strongly in the field. Europe was the first to, the first was the US, but the first network from Europe was in 2008, the CSIC network, linked six locations in Vienna with 200 kilometers fiber. And in 2016, in launch is a quantum technologies flagship. Every now and then, the Europe launches quite a big investment in a research field that they consider it has is going to have a big impact in Europe. The previous one was the graphene, and before that, the Blue Brain project for the study of the brain. So in this case, in 2016 was the time for quantum technologies in all the pillars of communication, computation, simulation, and sensing, on top of the fundamental pillar of basic science. And the first projects are already they're already running. The first tests in satellites, coming back a little bit to the satellite field, because we said it's critical and it's strategic to be able to have global quantum communications. We need these satellite communications. And Europe did its first test, the first ones back in 2015. Italy, it performed a demonstration through a corner reflecting cube in a LEO satellite. And, so, yeah, and analyze the back reflected light with several polarizations of the VB84 protocol. Then Germany in 2019, it did an experiment in the Canary Islands, receiving the signal of the geostationary satellite AlphaSat that emits in amplitude and phase modulation they analyzed the actual signal that was received in the receiver, and they checked that this signal was compatible with QKD and with a protocol for continuous variables. Also, China, in collaboration with Austria, they did a video conference using the satellite, the mission satellite, previously distributed keys by this satellite in both stations at 7,600 kilometers. Europe has launched also the Quantum Communication Infrastructure Initiative, which is an infrastructure that is going to link many cities in Europe. And it's going to have two segments, a terrestrial and a space segment. And its purpose is to protect Europe's communications from external threats. So it's going to, it's already the ramp up phase, is already happening. And it will take about 10 years for the development and deployment of this infrastructure. Regarding satellite programs, also the European Space Agency has launched several programs, such as the Skylight program, which includes the communications through satellites and through quantum cryptography. And the space-based branch is called SAGA. Hydron is for high throughput optical networks, is for high speed communications. The Netherlands have been very active for the quantum internet applications, which is the final aim of the quantum communication infrastructure, actually. And they have built a network that links Amsterdam, Delft, Leiden, and The Hague. And what is the quantum internet? Just to give you the actual definition, the quantum internet has as nodes quantum processors. So the network nodes are actually quantum processors that compute and store qubits. And communications lines are for transmitting qubits. So it's very important to work in the interface between these transmitting qubits and the computing qubits. And this is what they are, the actual quantum interfaces, which are many groups working in this. And of course, the other fundamental part of quantum internet is the quantum repeaters, which transport the qubits over long distances. So this is actually what we mean with quantum internet, but it's a very long term goal. I mean, we're very far from this, but it's the actual division. We're starting with just communication, QKD, and quantum computing, and we're slowly building all the parts to arrive to this final purpose. Madrid, Spain, and in particular Madrid, also Barcelona is quite active, but I just restricted to the work of the University Polytechnic of Madrid with my colleague Vicente Martín, that he performed a network back in 2018. This network had only three nodes, central node, Almagro and Concepción, with some equipment, QKD devices provided by Huawei Europe. And later on, in 2020, they are working more with ID Quantique equipment. And the future is to migrate all this the equipment to European producers, which is what Europe wants. That technology is built in Europe. And the key concept here, and this was the UPM, University Polytechnic of Madrid, has done extremely well, is the software-defined network. This means that these networks, which are carrying quantum signals and classical signals, because these are these standard networks, what you need to do to achieve this, which is very difficult, is to control the network at all times by software. So you basically, what you do is that when there's a quantum transmission, you decrease all the processes, all the classical processes, you stop them or decrease them, the intensity of them, so that you can launch your quantum signals and do your QKD transmission, and then after that you can continue. So this is the key concept, and this is what the UPM has done very extremely well. They have achieved quite a huge impact with this network that is currently has 11 nodes, and is linking CMAT, CSIC nodes, Telefonica, IMDEA, all many universities in Madrid, etc. And this this can actually change. There are some entities like the INTA. INTA is going to get his own node too. So this is all changing in good time. So United Kingdom is activity in quantum communications. They have encryptors with AES. And the keys of for this encryption is derived from QKD and Diffie-Hellman, both QKD and Diffie-Hellman. And they are very active within networks too, that go from the headquarters of British Telecom to Southampton and Bristol. Japan has also in 2010 it built its first networks with many partners, and later on they demonstrated the first transmission between a LEO satellite, CubeSat, from LEO orbit to ground. And this was Alberto Carrasco Casado worked in this team with Nature Communications, which was one our PhD student that graduated with us, and they're doing amazing work over there in NICT. Sorry. And China, as I said before, they demonstrated from the Mishu's satellite QKD with many protocols, BB84, entanglement base, etc., quantum teleportation too. They have built five ground stations from scratch. They have built the whole pointing, optical pointing and tracking, which you can see here. And it's a very, very difficult thing to do, because this kind of quantum signals, they need very precise pointing and tracking to operate. And they, fiber-wise, they have built 2,000 kilometers between Beijing and Shanghai. And they are planning to launch 10 more missions like missions, and to have a global network for 2030, a global network between satellite and fiber infrastructure, which they already have done some experiments to prove the viability of this. Mentioning also actors that are very involved in space and they're important, like Singapore, which have built a nano satellite that was launched by JAXA, by Japan, and to the International Space Station. And then it was put into orbit, and they also collaborate with the UK in this project, which the final goal is to share keys between Singapore and the UK. Canada also with a mission that is planned to be launched this year, in which the transmitter is going to be on Earth, suppose as normally was the case, is the opposite, but they're going to go through this approach, which has also some benefits, interesting benefits, which you can change the protocol on Earth, and you have more flexibility in that sense. But it's technically more difficult because the beam has to pass the atmosphere, so it gets more divert. The beam gets more deviated, and it's harder to get the receiver to find the receiver. So, finishing with my presentation, will we have a information security catastrophe with quantum computing? Well, it depends on this very simple graph that Michelle Mosca from the Institute of Waterloo did. So how long must keys be secure? You need X years, the security time, how long does the information must be kept secure? How long will it take you to adapt to current infrastructure that is quantum safe? That is Y years, so you have X and Y. And then how long will it take for a quantum computer to be built? That is set years. This is the collapse time. So if X plus Y is longer than Z, then you have a problem because you're late, basically. So this is a very visual way to actually see the problem. Estimations for this to happen, for when a quantum computer will be able to threaten security, have a chance by 2031, according to NIST, a decade, according to Microsoft. And we have to remember that information is exposed retroactively. So once somebody has a quantum computer, it will get access to information that's been encrypted before. And this can contain secret states from sensitive information from governments, intelligence, military, company's information that includes secrets that can compromise strongly his competitiveness in the world, information on critical infrastructures that are very important in a country because they affect millions of users, citizens' information that must be kept secret, as for example, our medical records, personal information, etc. So the conclusions are that quantum technologies are strategic and they can influence the geopolitical scenario worldwide. The Europe must stay in the leading pack to protect these critical infrastructures and avoid cyber threats. And each member state must develop their own secure infrastructure. So we need to work each of us in our own security methods. And that's it. Thank you so much. That's 1 hour and 30 minutes.
That's perfect. Thank you very, very much, Veronica. In fact, we are a bit out of time, but I think that we can answer the questions that I have put in the chat. The first one is, what is the use of public key in a RCA algorithm? What is the point of a key which is known to everyone?
Yes, well, the public key doesn't give anybody any information. It is used only to encrypt information. So you can use the receiver's public key to encrypt information, but you cannot you cannot get any information from that. So it's the person that is testing this information that can decrypt it. So you basically, you want to say hi to, or to say something encrypted to someone, you take his public key, encrypt it, you use it to encrypt, not to decrypt. So no information is revealed with it.
Perfect. The second question is, could you tell us a bit more about avalanche diodes? Is it still being improved and where?
Well, it's not really my field of expertise. I just use them. Okay. And I know his basic principles. I know they have been improved. I've used the silicon detectors, avalanche photo detectors. They have improved, especially their timing jitter, which is basically how precise they are in time. So the more precise you, the less is this timing jitter, the higher the frequency you can operate them. So since I started using them, this has improved quite a big. So you can use them, silicon detectors, you can use it for higher than 1 gigahertz and even about 2 gigahertz operation they can achieve now. So this is important. And for the superconducting detectors, I will tell you in a few months, because I'm planning to buy a set of 4 superconducting detectors, and they are very, they're much better in terms of detection efficiency than the standard APDs, the standard avalanche photodiodes. So they're more than double the detection efficiency, and the dark count rates are much lower, like 1/10 of them. So they're more expensive, but they're much better.
Yes, and we have 2 more questions. Yes, one is, can you explain further how do you produce entangled photon pairs?
I don't work with entangled photon pairs. I work with the BB84, B92, and BB84. So all I know is this that I explained you. You need to find the exact coincident cones where you get the entangled effect. Unfortunately, I cannot tell you anything more than that. This is a mechanical, quantum mechanic effect that no one really knows why, how it happens, but it happens. Or maybe people are more clever than me know more than me, but it's a very mysterious effect. Even Einstein didn't really believe in it. So that's all I can say.
No, absolutely. In fact, I study a bit and I work a bit in a Max Planck. And for that, I used to, the emitter did photon pairs by having a non-linear crystal. But of course, yes. Nothing was done over there, just detecting and nothing else.
Yes, exactly. Thank you. Non-linear detectors. Mm-hmm. Yeah, crystals. Yes.
But, thank you very much. And the last question, Veronica, how do we know that quantum systems truly generate random numbers?
These are standard techniques, mathematical standard techniques. So you basically analyze how many ones and zeros you have, the proportion of ones and zeros, and how are they placed in your sequence, and you determine with their algorithms, standard to find algorithms or calculations, depending how you see it, that they can tell you how good your random numbers are. This is, I have colleagues that are specialists in this, and they actually do this analysis. So this can be done.
Perfect. So thank you very, very much. Veronica, it has been a really, really good really, really good session. In fact, I wanted to ask you some questions, but you finally covered them by the estimation, etc. So that's perfect. Thank you very much to be here, Veronica.
Thank you, Alberto, for inviting me, and you all have a nice day.
You too. A great pleasure. Bye-bye. Thank you very much.
The same. Bye-bye.